Hello and welcome to Portugal. We're at the Montemor Velo Racecourse and it's going to be a huge day's racing to look forward to today. The conditions are so much better than a couple of days ago when we had crosswinds. It looks like we have strong tailwinds, so expect some fast timing today. We're going to be watching 10 races live with you. It's not the same setup as the last couple of years, so we're switching from 200 to 500 to 1,000 and back again. It's going to be really exciting fun. As ever, I'm Matthew Layton. I'm enjoying today the company of two winners from yesterday. We have Lockie Tame, who's going to take the first half of the show from Australia, obviously a legend in his ski surf sport, but came across to competing in he started with K1, now he's going for the K2, and won yesterday in 1,000 metres. And then later in the day, we're going to have Kenny Wallace, who CV is too long to mention, but look forward to speaking to you in a few minutes. So, Lockie, good morning.
G'day, Matt, how you going?
It's looking good. The actual conditions, they say, which have lovely warm weather, lovely tailwind. You've been out there frequently on the water. What actually are the conditions? I read something in your Facebook yesterday that you were saying that some of the waves are rather choppy and quite difficult.
Yeah, it's pretty windy out there. It's different. Like, it looks fast, but it also slows you down a bit. We were going through waves and Kenny was getting splashed in the face. So, you know, that kind of affects the run of the boat when you're racing.
Well, here they are. We're actually at the bottom of the tower. In front of you, you can see the lineup we're going to actually follow. So it's final after final. We're having two little breaks where we're going to have the ceremonies. We're going to have the K1 women and the K1 men we're going to be looking at. But apart from that, as you see, we see the whole range of disciplines available in this sprint sport. And it's starting off with the C1 200 meters. It's not an Olympic event yet, but it will be. So that's going to be really interesting to see the actual the depth of the girls here. Remember, we saw in Moscow in the Worlds last year where they had probably similar conditions, very, very strong tailwinds. We saw Vincent Lapointe. She went in 46.4 seconds. I don't know if you're going to have the same sort of times, but I think yesterday we had some good times.
That's pretty good with one blade. I'd like to do that time.
We're going to see what actually comes up. There's the actual there's the start where they're going to be coming on. They're due to start in about 3 or 4 minutes, but let's look at the start list. I have two from Canada, two from Spain, and Brazil. Going down the line, we have the star of this sport. She's been competing since 2010. It's Lance Vincent Lapointe from Canada. Very long, very rangy. She is the lady who won last year. Adriana Panigueira, she's 17 years old from Spain. In the Europeans a couple of weeks ago, she actually came eighth. This is the lady I was talking about, the star of this discipline. She's really pushing it forward in the world scene, and also especially in Canada. There's quite a few girls coming on. She was actually beaten in a couple of events early last year, but that's because she had no preparation for studies. Nascimento came third in the Worlds last year, so it's going to be interesting to watch her. She's actually quite old. She's 25 years old, and a lot of them are new. Katie Vincent was actually quite a late entry here, so we actually have to see how she performs. But yesterday with Lawrence, she actually won the gold in the C2 200 metres, and Patricia Coco takes up the level. She's be very difficult her on recent performances to actually make the medals, because she's a bit off the pace in the Europeans. I think she came eighth with 6 seconds off the pace. Lockie, what's your expertise in this discipline?
I know it's very tippy and they want to try and stay in, but the wind's much easier from today with the tailwind. They're not going to be struggling to line up, so hopefully they can get in there and set a cracking time for themselves. But I'm looking for Brazil. I reckon they're going to have a good crack in this race.
Well, we'll actually see. I don't make no predictions. You can see actually the weather there. You see it's the tailwind. It looks fair at the moment. We actually have the flags right in front of us, and it looks like we're going to have a tough race, so possibly not benefiting either side. We saw in the heats a couple of days ago, the huge advantage. But here they go. They're off for around about 40, 50 seconds worth of action. As we see straight away, it's Lawrence with the white middle red-fronted boat, really going and taking a good lead out straight away. She should win this race fairly straightforwardly, but she is saying this is my race already.
Yeah, she's looking dominant out front. She's got a very good stroke on there, very long, very forward, flying very well for a seaman.
Yeah, so she had some balance last year with some very difficult studies and actually coming across. But it looks like for second place the race is going to be. Who's going to take the medals? And Katie Vincent on the top of your screen. And in
Canada one too.
Well, it could be a Canada one too, and we also have Brazil is in there, Spain falling back at the moment. They're coming over the line at the moment. It's an easy victory in the end of the day for Canada. Second at the top is Canada as well, and in lane number six, it's Nascimento, who As we mentioned, she took the bronze medal in the Worlds last year. She's taken another bronze medal in the first World Cup in 2015. And it's Laurence Vincent-Lapointe, 22 years old, is still dominating this sport and pushing it forward. So it's going to be interesting to see in the next couple of weekends where perhaps we have a bit of a stronger depth of field. How is she going to perform when the pressure's on? Because the pressure was perhaps internal today.
Yeah, it was. You know, that's always the biggest one. But she turned up, there's people to race, and that's what you've got to do on every day. You've got to give your best in every single race.
Absolutely. In intermission, your weekend so far?
It's been good. It's obviously a new experience for me still. This time last year, I was racing K1 200 and doing my best to crack into that. So it was nerve-wracking, and I had a lot of expectations to live up to, I thought, racing with Kenny, because he is the master of racing. And I just had to get in that back behind him and tuck in and do my best.
And so far, your career in K2 is worst ever result. Kenny was telling me yesterday is the silver medal in the world.
Yeah, we're setting ourselves up as a crew for a good failure at some point. So we're just going to have to hang on and see if we get beaten. But
let's have a look at the unofficial results. It's Canada 1, Canada 2, and Brazil coming in third. 47.3, that's a hot time, isn't it?
Yeah, that's a solid time. It must be good conditions out there.
Well, no world records officially, because it's very difficult to actually judge with different conditions an outdoor sport, as you'd appreciate, but it's a good start. As I say, we are cracking on quickly. That's one women's event to go, gone rather, and the next event is one of the blue ribbon events for the women. It's an Olympic event. It's going to be the K1 200 metres, and that's something that you know quite a little about 200 metres. The stresses that these girls are going through?
Yeah, I suppose they're trying to really get their body firing. They're doing their last little sprints and things like that. But yeah, this should be an interesting race. I was actually speaking to Lisa last night and asking her when was the last time she lost a 200 race. So I don't want to put the mark on her, but
it's a long time ago. Let's look at some of the others as well. We have Sarah Guyot from France in lane three, specialising training in their 200 this year, and she won the Europeans 2 weeks ago. Carolina Naya is getting stronger and bigger every year from Poland, has often been in the medals. Teresa Portela, the local girl. So three or four girls that can really push Lisa Carrington. But like you mentioned, the answer to her question when she said how long she's been beaten?
I think it was in a World Cup pre-London, so a few years now.
But yesterday she won the 500 metres, as we know, and can't do absolutely anything wrong at the moment. She's serenity, and let's hope she keeps that going. And well done, New Zealand, because obviously they're putting an amazing programme together. Carolina Naya, 24 years old now, from Poland. The Polish girls, there's six or seven Polish girls who are really mixing it up and going in all sorts of events. Here in your picture, Lisa Carrington, watch out for the tip of her boat. She starts off quickly, and she does the midsection more quickly and finishes even more quickly.
If you look out for Speller, it's her first race back since having a baby.
Last September. Here we go in your picture. It's Sago. She was on the verge last year, but she's obviously done something right over winter training. And Teresa Portello, there's two Teresa Portellos in this game. She's the only one competing this weekend. The other one's from Spain. China, we have King Mai, who had a couple of good results, and it's difficult to know how the Chinese form are. Here's the Speller, as you know, she had a little boy last September, so she's got experience. She's been into the Olympic Games several times. And Vicky Schwartz, she won the K2 200 yesterday, but she said that was just no training for that. We just decided to have a go. Michelle Russell, obviously, is an ex-under-23 world champion. That's in the 500 metres, but do you know much about himself?
I watched her race in the 500s, and she got it really hard, so she obviously he's a 200 piloter and she did her best and hung on, but I'm looking for her here in the lane 9.
Well, it's a pretty much, we can have realistically, I'd say six or seven of the girls can be up there. Look out for Lisa in the black and white boat in the middle. See how her start is, and all the other girls expecting a fast time of well. We should be under 40 seconds for these girls.
Ready. Oh, the nerves at this time are massive.
And they're off. Looks like Carolina Lyo in lane number 5 had a good start, and lane number 7 of well in the yellow boat is Teresa Portello got out there. Right at the bottom, Michelle Russell of Wales, who's looking good. But so far, it's lane number 3, it's Sarah Gayo from France, who really pushed Lisa Carrington closely in the first heat. But this is where Lisa suddenly puts the extra gear on, and she's doing it again. She's pulling away from most of the field. It's Sarah Gayo in lane number 3 is also holding on. It's a very short race. They're coming in front of us here. There's 50 metres to go. It's going to be a Lisa Carrington first. Who's going to take the second medal? It looks like France is up there, closely followed by Cuba, we haven't mentioned yet, but Lisa Carrington storms away. She's going to take the victory by a half and three quarters of a boat length.
Cuba
and second. It looks like Cuba have taken it.
Massive for Cuba. She had a good race yesterday, I saw, and that's awesome there for her. But Lisa Carrington dominant again. She must have her Under Armour on today.
Well, we're looking for as many sponsors as we can actually get in this sport, and there's great return investments, I believe. But Lisa Carrington, she just is so consistent, isn't she?
Yeah, that's. She didn't even have a great start then, like, from looking at it. She got loft behind a little bit, but she doesn't muck around. She just keeps on knuckling down and goes all the way.
So it'd be interesting to see. She's actually, I think she's going to all World Cups this year. Most of the New Zealand team are going on to Duisburg, and then some are going home. Later today, we have Amadi McDowell going in the K1 500. It's going to be interesting to see. And then we have the very dynamic, exciting new team in the K4 women to end the show today. So lots of activity going on in New Zealand. But look at this.
She looks good in that new Nello Cinco. It looks like it's running really well out there for her.
So we've seen Nello Cinco come from really nothing to, I'd say, probably about 30% of the boats now, the top ones, are racing in them.
It's a dominant boat. Like, it's obviously new. This is one of the first regattas it's been to, other than the Europeans, but it seems to be doing the trick. It's won both K1s, or all K1s so far, I think.
I suppose the clear feature of the boat has got the inverse bow. Apart from that, they say that, here you go, look on the actual picture, you see the front of Lisa's boat is actually looks like the boat's almost upside down. There's about five or six major changes. They talk about new, more stability, different rubber shape, but it's all about the technique and power of Lisa Carrington and her very dynamic boat as she just keeps the level pushing and pushing and pushing. And takes her.
Very humble there. She's always just crossing the line, calm and collected. She knows that, you know, one race at a time, it's a big year. She's got two more World Cups and a World Champs to come.
An official victory. We're looking at Lisa Carrington, who certainly crossed the line first in 39.5. is Maria Rodriguez from Cuba. Great result there. And Zoe Gua from France. I say she's come off some really hot form. She peaked a couple of weeks ago. This is the last World Cup we're going to see her at, by the way. She's going off some training, then going to Baku for the European Championships. Caroline Nye came in fourth. And as we mentioned, Michelle Russell, who had a good start, she actually managed only to come fifth at the moment. Or this last race, rather. So, Lockie, your first impressions, we've seen two of the women's races, and they've been, first one was not close at all, but a dominant display, and the second one, I suppose, dominant as well. But
it's always close racing, you know, it's always within a second, and it's hard out there, but two masters of their fields, I suppose, like, the Canadians have been beaten for a long time, and either has Lisa. So they're both, you know, turning up.
K1 men 200 meters A final, and we do have some big names here. Mark de Jong yesterday didn't make it through straight from his heat. We have Cesar Cesare from Ecuador, who's always up there. Maxime Beaumont, you said yesterday, he looked really, really smart. His K2 partner is Sebastian Jouvet, also there. Tim Hornsby, good to see him in lane number 8 from the USA. And Miklos Dudas, the biggest giant you'll ever see in lane. How do you see this? Because obviously this is your specialist event.
It used to be my specialist event. I'd be lucky to break 40 seconds. But Maxime Beaumont, he looked amazing yesterday. He won his heat, like, clearly doing a 34-0 something yesterday. So I'm tipping him for some early season form. But never to count out Mark de Jong, and Caesar to Caesar, he's got a cracking name.
So he absolutely said Sebastian Jouvet. He won twice the World Championships in 2010 and 2011. Mark de Jong is the fastest time ever recorded, I believe, a couple of times for him, and also he is the reigning world champion. So there's something going on there.
Yeah, that's, you can never count out a champion. That's what they say.
This is your born in Argentina, moved to Ecuador. His English is getting better, which is great.
Yeah, it's always good to have a conversation with him. I try my best, but.
And Tim Hornsby of Wales, he's out there alone for the USA. He turns a lot of time with the Canadians, and he looked really, really good yesterday. Yeah. Peng Zhu from China. Again, we have 28 or 29 competitors coming in from China. Miklos Dudas, great work of arts on his back, but he took a win out last year. Let's see how he can perform. But I saw him warming up, and it's like a racehorse almost.
He does have a big back, so he might as well put a lot of artwork on there.
Here we go, and they're off. And who's going to take the first few strokes? It looks like in lane number 8 we have.
There's a blanket across the field
really
so far.
Maxime Beaumont in your picture there, putting in a race. But we have 7 boats in a row.
Yeah, it's tight. But Maxime Beaumont.
Sebastian Jouvet also looks in lane number 6, so you can see. But now it's where Mark de Jong should put his power down, but hasn't done it yet. Maxime Beaumont, and you could have a French 1-2 if it keeps going at this rate. Mark de Jong yet to go in lane number 4. We have Carlos Garotti also, but at the moment, it's going to be too close to call. It looks like lane 5 might have it from de Jong.
Looks like France, Canada, France. Maxime Beaumont may be in first there, unofficially from the naked eye in the box down here from us.
Well, that's what the cameras are looking at, and they're saying that Maxime Beaumont, who I believe was second in the French trials a couple of weeks ago, so they're certainly on form because they took a big team to the Europeans as well. It's good timing for them. We don't know where other athletes are in their season, but certainly he looked good yesterday.
And I think they got second in the K2 200, so that's a pretty good effort from those guys to get first and third, as we believe here, and second in the K2, but yeah, he looks massive.
Dudosh was left on the line. I don't know what happened there because we were calling in, but look in lane number five. It's fairly clear, isn't it? It's just a case of who's going to take the second. Is it Marc de Jong from Canada or Sébastien Jouvet?
I think it's Marc de Jong, and then a very tight for third and fourth between the Spanish and French.
Well, I suppose it's early season, and pretty much everyone I've been speaking to from an outsider's point of view, so they probably don't tell me what they're really thinking, says, well, it's nice to do good here, but it's all about August. It's all about the Worlds in Milan.
Yeah, that's a cracking time.
First of all, they're talking about the official timing. So this is what happens. It's Maxime Beaumont takes the win. Marc de Jong takes second. And Sébastien Jouvet takes there. The time is 33.996, which...
That is one of the quickest times I've ever seen written on the board.
Well, that's good. That's good too. I guess the conditions possibly couldn't be much better. There's not too much waves out there, and there's a cracking tailwind.
Yeah, it seems to calm down in the last... Well, since we first sat down, it's a bit flatter out there at the moment. So that's exactly what you're looking for. A lot of wind, but not too many ripples on the water, not too many waves like we had yesterday.
Well, I suppose, as I mentioned a minute ago, this is, it's not irrelevant. It's all about peaking in August at Milan. But yeah. Here, it's still maybe a bit of a surprise to see Marc de Jong not taking the win, but I'll have to ask him.
Still low 34s, it's pretty good. I suppose if he's not peaking now, I'd be pretty happy with that come August, personally. But yeah, that's it. Everyone's got 14 weeks to produce their best now. But everyone wants to have a good gauge, and I suppose you want to tell yourself that you're feeling good. But it's all jobs to do now.
Well, these guys were automatically put through to the finals. This is the first time we're actually going to see them here. It's the C2 men, 200 meters. We saw the C1 women about half an hour ago. Who's going to win it? Well, it's up for grabs. We don't have any of the big, big names, perhaps. We don't have the Russians or the Germans, but it'll be interesting to see who turns up today.
I had a coffee with the Canadian guys over there. I reckon they could be in for a bit of a shot, but that's only just because I know them.
Well, here they are in your picture now.
Yes, Max Pullen and Aaron Rubley. They were nice guys and always good to have a conversation with.
Yeah, the brothers. We actually had these in yesterday as the commentary team. Ian Ross in the back, the giant, and younger 19-year-old brother Gavin Ross. Their father was an Olympian, or certainly raced at international level. They struggled a little bit. Perhaps they weren't really going for it about an hour ago in the B final of the C2 1000, but perhaps they were just pacing themselves, and this is their main event. We'll have to actually...
They might have some speed to burn.
And see,
oh, the nerves when you're lining up into the gate, they're always tough, you know, your heart's racing, you're trying to do some deep breaths and control them and obviously be optimal, ready to go, but it never ceases to amaze me how, like, it never goes away. For me personally, it's always hard, like, and these guys, they're balancing on the one knee, I couldn't imagine doing that.
And you've had 5 or 6 or maybe more years right at the pinnacle of the surf ski world. Is it the same sort of pressure when you're on the beach ready to go?
It's different, I suppose. It's... You got things to take your mind off it. You got waves to look at and stuff like that. But you know here these guys have got, I don't know, what time do they do? 35 seconds. And they're in. They're in for a world of pain.
Okay. But this is a choice. It's your choice. No one's forcing you to do it. So it's
that's why we love it.
Who's going to be able to put the Ross... USA, Kazakhstan in one, USA, followed by Portugal, Poland, and Canada. So the cheering is clearly going to be going for Alfonso and Silva in lane number 4, right in the middle of your picture. There we go. As you say, just less than 40 seconds of pain, and it's a great start in lane number 5 for the Polish. So Kaminski and Kudla, both obviously very experienced racers, but it looks like they've taken off the first level.
Not the Polish, pretty tight between the Portuguese and the Canadians, but the Canadians seem to have a lot of bounce going on. I like the look of their canoe. It's great, but they seem to just be clearing away from the Portuguese here. Maybe coming back on the Polish a tiny bit, but a lot of red and white going on.
Well, the Poland have said, certainly, we want this race. Only 30 metres to go, and they have wrapped it up already. It's going to be Poland crossing the line first, a boat length ahead of the second, and lane number six, it's going to be the Canadians. So you said you're hoping they have something.
Yeah.
Going home with a medal, which is great stuff.
Must have been the Portuguese tarts and the croissants we ate on Thursday afternoon.
Well, probably the croissants.
So, yes, it was very nice. But they look at them, they're stoked. It's always good, like, it's winning a race is winning a race, and they're just absolutely stoked. Good on them.
That's not Slavinsky. Slavinsky is racing every race you can do it with a canoe. He's actually racing in this
sounds weekend. Like Ken Wallace, a canoe.
Well, hasn't quite got to that, that level of performance yet, but he's certainly he's won World Cups in C2 1000 before, and just really saying, listen, give me a go in everything. He's in the 1000, the 500. So pretty much soon, I think we're going to be due for a medal ceremony. The way the actual TV works, because obviously we're packing in 10 races in the live schedule today, we don't have time to show all 10 medal ceremonies. So the two have been chosen, the two of the early races. They're just literally walking in front of us here. We have giving out the medals is the Secretary General of the International Canoe Federation, Simon Toulson, joined by the head of New Zealand, because it is Lisa Carrington who always takes the gold medal. That's just the rule. It doesn't matter who lines up, it's Lisa to take it. So there we go, just lining up. And we say we have Cuba also in there.
Yeah, that's awesome. I saw her yesterday, and she was stoked to win the B final, I think. So to get her a medal today in the 200 is awesome. Like, it's great.
And also, this must be great preparation. I know the Canadians in the middle of their trial section, where it's the best out of three who goes through. Mark Young actually went through already. But it's the official results, by the way, of the last race we saw 2 minutes ago. Poland take it from Canada, who take it from Portugal in just under 37 seconds. So you said 37 we're looking at, not too far on. The picture's going to swing across to the medal ceremony in a couple of seconds. And I guess this is what it's all the hard work's worth about. You're competing against other athletes, and if you can get to the top of the podium, great stuff.
Yeah, it's pretty special. That for me yesterday, I was singing really loud in Kenny's ear. To hear my national anthem when I was standing up there was amazing, and I think he was nearly laughing because I was trying to sing so loud to put him off. But
apparently Kenny holds the official world record for taking a selfie and getting on his Twitter account. It's about 3 seconds.
He does love a selfie.
Probably a couple of on of the commentary box if you actually want to watching. The crowd, well, they put in quite a few kids yesterday. We had school children, and it was a great atmosphere. We are not in the middle of nowhere. We're in a secluded area.
Yeah, it's about a 15-minute drive from the other towns that I suppose a lot of the athletes are staying down.
So you're at Dafoz, which is on the coast,
yeah.
which is very quiet this time of year, buzzing in the actual summer. And Montemor Velho, the actual course here, it was built... It used to be used a lot with the rowers, so using a little bit less now. They made some big improvements 5 or 6 years ago. But here we go. It's going to be the first ceremony of the day, and it's the K1 women 200 metres. Same protocol all the time. We have the ladies leading them on. Then we'll have Simon Toulson, as I mentioned. He gives out the gongs. And then we'll have a bit of a quiet moment when we let the athletes take the glory of the national anthem, so we don't speak through that moment. But it's Sarah Guyot in your picture and Lisa Carrington are expected to be there.
Yeah, I suppose everyone's always got expectations, but to get there is another thing. So it's familiar faces, you might say, that, you know, they've been up there before.
But Ismaria Rodriguez, Cuba coming through, it helps them for the Pan American Games, which for many athletes is one of the highlights of their year in Toronto in July.
A lot of racing. There's a lot of racing for the Europeans and the American sectors of the world this year with the Baku Games and the things like that. So
that partly explains why there's perhaps a selected field here today. A lot of the Germans aren't here, the Russians aren't here. The Hungarians have a few of their top athletes here, but they're doing their trials at the moment. Yesterday there was a trial for the K2 1000, which is it's a huge shock because they had internal triads, and Zoltan Kamo, he actually won the trial there yesterday.
So still got it. He's still charging.
Anyway, it's Sarah Guyot from France who steps onto the podium to take the bronze medal today. So she won the Europeans a couple of weeks ago, so it says that it was no fluke there. long picture. Saw Simon Tools a couple of minutes ago. Did you actually, you mentioned you do something specific with the bouquet of flowers. Did you give it to some?
It's still strapped to my backpack, but yeah, we've got to do something with it.
Yes, we now have in Yusmani Rodriguez from Cuba, who's delighted to take the silver medal. And yeah, as we saw yesterday, we saw father and son, where Mark Aldershaw was given the medal by Scott. It must be quite special to keep it in the family. Probably see Kenny doing that in about 20 years. Well, they'll be competing, probably. Lisa Carrington steps up for New Zealand, great ambassador for the sport. Apparently, since she's come to profile, 10 times more women are actually competing in New Zealand, so they've got a good depth of field, and it looks like they're doing everything right. She obviously has a massive amount of pressure on her shoulders, but she doesn't show it.
She's very, very cool, calm and collected, and always ready to have a chat with anyone. She's a very approachable kind of person.
Time for the national anthem. Carrington takes the medal for winning the K1 women's 200 metres. Yesterday she won the K1 women's 500 metres, which is also a major achievement to do the double again and again and again. And she just goes from strength to strength. Always a kind word for the others. I think it's probably she's such a star now that people are actually quite pleased to be taking photographs with her.
Yeah, it's a special moment.
So it's all toward gearing your performance and your training, I guess, to peak this year in Milan. You boys, are you fixed in the K2 1000
yet? We're fixed together. We're a team. We're like two peas in a pod. But no, we don't know. We'd do anything. We've got to wait and see. We've got to put our best foot forward for the country. So we'll wait and see after these three World Cups. And if something needs to be done or whatever, we'll do it. But I suppose worst case scenario, we're in the K2, which is that's pretty handy.
That's okay. And is there for next week? Is it for Duisburg? Because the World Cup series is three weekends this season. We start obviously where we are today in Portugal. Next weekend we go to Duisburg, which is in Germany, as you all know, and then we go to Copenhagen, which we haven't been for a while in Denmark. Are you fixed yet? What are you going to be doing next week?
Not as certain, but yeah, we hope.
That means no.
Yeah, Kenny's shrugging his shoulders back there, and he's the captain of the ship, so I'm going to say we're not fixed yet.
Okay, but it keeps you on your toes. When do you actually go on to Duisburg?
We're out of here this afternoon. We got a good flight straight up to Germany, so we got no mucking around. We're going to watch the K4 and boom, on a bus and on the plane. So
that sounds good news to me. Well, I've got one more event for you, Lockie, then we're going to switch over to Kenny Wallace. If you've got anything to say, you need to get it out now so you have no regrets.
No regrets. I've got no regrets in here. I'm having a great time. We've got the K1 Women 1000 Finale A.
We have Christina Fazagazur and Marta Voltakevich, who, again, a bit like the Kenny Wallace, they're going for every event they actually can this weekend. Voltakevich is renowned as one of the top two or three sprinters in the 200 metres in the world this year, so I don't know why she hasn't gone for that, but I guess she's just doing some training. And in Hungary, Christina Fazagazur, again, she's the same thing. She trains by herself, so away from the rest of the Hungarian team. Apparently, the inside word is she should do really well in this. She's got hasn't done her short sprint training at the moment. She's still for the long training, so she has lots of endurance, so she should do well. Other girls we've seen, we have in lane number one from China. Again, they're putting out lots of different athletes this week. It's amazing to see how they perform. Here's a familiar face, is Laura Pedrula from Spain. We've already seen her a couple of times this weekend, see how she can go on. Spain haven't been that really present the last couple of years in the World Cup circuit, so it's good to see them making the trip across the dividing line. Ed Van Tonder from South Africa. We are now the following bridge at Hartley, and there's a bit more strength in depth. They're producing really, really strong-looking athletes, aren't they? They're real athletes producing.
It's amazing. It only takes one raindrop to create a waterfall, so there's more paddlers coming through now, so it's good to see.
Who else can we see in the picture at the moment? Well, they seem to be focusing very much on her at the moment.
I believe it's Krista's from Hungary's first regatta back since having a baby 12 months ago. Little Noah, a little cute dude running around the regatta.
Well, there she is in the picture. Obviously, she's part of the Olympics. Has gold medals galore. And it'll be interesting to see if she can take a place back in the K4. That's what they're all going for. Marta Voltakiewicz, I say she's always the bridesmaid, never the mad, in the sense that she's taken a lot of silvers behind Lisa Carrington. I guess you're looking. Anna Lahadji, yesterday we saw her win the gold in the K2 200, which again wasn't a priority for her. And she just maybe felt a bit of fun. They actually just missed out because they raced half an hour later in the K2 500. And Ana Viguts from Brazil. It's good to see Brazil coming forward quite a lot.
They've got a lot of people in the Brazil shed I've seen over the weekend, so it's great to see.
When you're talking about the sheds, there's a huge airline hangar, which is about 150 meters long, and all the teams are put together. So you must take some close contact. Tiffany Kruger again, long and light. So they have the same mold in South Africa coming forward. And here they are. They're off for 1,000 meters. As I say, we're switching all the time from the 200s, which the pace was a little bit more. The tactics of this race, they can't go full out all the way, can they?
No, definitely not. I've tried that. It doesn't work. But I've been getting coached lately, so it's good we're getting some tactics. But no, you've got to look at who looks like they've got the good boat run so far. But if you look at Krista from Hungary, she's looking very, very good, very, very long and strong.
This is Marta Vodzkiewicz again. Yesterday she had to double up her two races in half an hour. That was in the pairs. But so far it is Christina Fazagas-Zier, lane number three in the white boat, being closely followed by China. I wonder if that's a tactic to keep them out. But here she goes. How would you describe her stroke?
Very slow. She's very powerful on the catch and, gets a lot of body on there. So it's very efficient, you would say. But it's so low. I couldn't rate that low. If I tried, I'd fall out.
Well, a quarter of the way through the race. Luckily, she can. And the new tying out the Cinque boat. As I say, with Hungary, pretty much the whole season. I was talking to a couple of the athletes yesterday, and I said, you've done well. You perhaps haven't done as well as you want. It's like, really, I don't care. This doesn't matter. This is just a test for me. The main Hungarian trials are going to take forward two batches. So I'm going to start in a couple of weeks' time. And that's what it's all about.
Making the team. You've got to get in the team and then get your job done this year. That's an important job.
Well, we're so far seeing two of the girls breaking away. It's Hungary at the top of your picture in the white boat. I'm colorblind, but it looks fairly bluish next to me for the Chinese boat. And you can see in the back there, they're actually just dropping off the pace a little bit. But she's done a lot of racing so far.
Yeah, she's just so efficient. I would not want her to have to train against her because I think she'd give me a run for my money in these longer, harder efforts. So.
Well, halfway through the race, I say the inside track, she's done a lot of endurance race, a lot of training in the last few weeks. She's apparently entered all the events just to see where she is.
Yeah, that's it. It's a good gauge for the early start of the year, but it's also good just to go through that pain. We don't want to shy away from the pain, but it's always hard, and you've got to put yourself out there to hurt. But I suppose if you get it done right, it could be good at the end of the day.
Well, we're coming to you live from Portugal. You probably recognise the voice, but it's Lockie Tame, who took a great victory out yesterday, and from Australia at the moment. And we're coming up to the business end, they say, of the course with Christina Fazagas-Zier, really putting on almost an exhibition here.
Yeah, she's looking amazing out there. You can see Rami, her husband, riding out there. He'd be yelling at her, cheering her on. So she's looking very good. There's probably a baby sit on that bike you can see over there. We're just a little baby with a dummy in its mouth. It's having a great time in the wind.
And the world champion at the moment is Tennille Hatton. Well, she's sitting out the domestic season, looking to concentrate in the 500 meters. She needs to change her training, but she put on a great performance, a gutsy performance in the end of the Worlds last year. And they're closing in on her a little
bit. Yeah, the Spanish seem to have a little bit of a kick here with 200 to go. Really rating it up, looking good.
Well, so far with 150 meters to go in lane number three, she's led from pillar to post. It's Christina Fazagas-Zer. And more pictures of her. Do you see her tying up, or what do you see?
No, she's looking. I think she's just really racing the race, as Kenny tries to teach her. You got to feel where your opponents are doing. But yeah, she's just really dominant out there right now. She's looking very good.
Spain coming back. Can they take the second position? China at the top of your picture. And also, we do have South Africa maybe looking to do a move, but so far with 50 meters to go, it is going to be a very clear victory for Hungary. They already have two medals this weekend. They're leading the medal table. She crosses first. Lane number five is second for Laura Pedrola from Spain. A good result there.
Very tight between the two China. Is that two Chinese there? Lane four and lane one. That was very tight.
That's correct. Their focus is always on the Asian Games and a little bit more on the Olympic Games. It's interesting to see what their tactics are going to be this weekend, but there's only one winner out there today. There's Ballant, the photographer. He was interesting because he was promised to have a very stable place to stay, and they put him on a little rubber boat, so it's going to be interesting to see he comes away from the actual what sort of pictures, but obviously we'll produce great pictures as always.
Looks more stable than a kayak, he'll be right.
He's fine, but he's an ex-world junior champion in kayak, so he's whatever you give him, he's fine. But here we go. Just describe again her style.
Very long and very powerful. Like, she's got a lot of power down in the water. No strokes are slipping through the water, and that chinko looks really good underneath her. It's not moving side to side, just straight ahead. So it's always efficiency is the key.
And that's what it says on the brochure.
Oh, really?
So that's
I haven't even read the brochure, and I just knew it in the back of my head.
Okay, well, there you go. That's the insider point of view. Well, we're reaching the halfway point now. We're going to hopefully not make too much noise. We've got Lockie Tame, who's going to step to one side and probably a noise in the background. And unfortunately, Kenny Wallace has to stop tweeting for a couple of minutes. Here we go. The unofficial results so far. We have Hungary, followed by Spain, followed by China in three and four. Very, very close together with, you can see the other results, but it's Hungary now has their third gold medal of the weekend, so it's although they have a very diminished team, they certainly know what they're doing.
All right, I better jump off. Thanks for having me, Maddie.
Thank you, and sweet Jesse. Kenny, take over, please. There you go. Hopefully it wasn't too painful. We're checking out for the next event. It's going to be the C2 men over 1,000 meters. And we have Coletta and Grabowski. They haven't much experience. We're looking at the records. They haven't been really racing together. They did a lot individually. But you can't say the same to these two. Ben Russell and Gabby Bushnev-Sevigny. Gabby used to race with Ben's brother in the Olympics a few years ago. Good to have Turkey in this event. They haven't got a huge team, but it's great to see them coming through. Looking for France, Huguet and Barth. They've been together quite a bit at the moment. Obviously, a bit of a different size differential, but we'll see how they come together at the moment. Kaminski and Kudla, the second Polish pair. Again, they're mixing them up a lot, Poland, at the moment. So it'd be interesting to see what their tactics are. And China, I don't know a great deal about this pair. Interesting just to discover. And obviously, Pregel and Sierra, a young team. They had to go through the semi-finals, but let's see how they come on. And Hungary, again, have another. Well, they can put out teams all day. Good morning, Kenny.
Good morning.
So it's 1,000 metres, it's racing. How are you on your canoe racing?
Yeah, it's hard for us to call the canoe guys. It's always good to see. We don't have too many canoeists in Australia. So coming over to World Cups and seeing these guys here, we see some very familiar faces. So it's always good to see them out racing and going hard. But yeah, 1,000 metres in a C2, it's not easy.
So let's take them from an actual racing perspective. That's the information we'd like to get you from today. Well, in lane number eight, the Spaniards have certainly gone out quicker than anyone else. Will they be able to keep this pace going through that race?
Yeah, I'm not too sure. The Spaniards seem to be, they're always fast in no matter what boat they are in. K1, K2, C1, C2, they're always fast out of the block. So it'll be interesting to see whether they can hold on to some of the more experienced crew. So Yeah, it'll be hard for him. But with these tailwind conditions, if you are fast out of the blocks, you tend to drag that start out a little bit longer.
And with obviously David Cowell, who's put down a great legacy for Spanish canoeing, he's just recently announced his retirement. That must have been inspired a lot of these youngsters coming through. At the moment, it looks like, well, we know that Kaminski and Kudlev from Poland have started to slightly pull away in lane number 7.
Yeah, it's still a long race, but they look like they're very controlled. They're going long strokes. Yeah, they do look controlled. They look great out there at the moment. So, and Poland has a very big canoe training regime as such there. So they keep just pumping out canoes. Them and Canada.
Absolutely. Close up of them. They came, was it last result when I had for them in the World Cup in Szeged last year? They put in a fifth performance. So they seem to be really mixing and matching them here. Over halfway, and there's still 5 boats in the race at the moment.
Yeah, just going through the halfway mark there. There are 5 boats still in the race. It still will be a tight race, I think, towards the end here. As who's got the legs on them to carry through this third 250 metres is always going to be tough, no matter what boat you're in. The finish is over, and you've got to get past the halfway mark. Once you get there, you kind of through your head psychologically, you think, oh, geez, I've got to do that all over again.
Well, so far we have Poland, Afolo, and at the top of your picture in the white tip boat, it's France who are still holding in there. Instinct to see in the red T-shirts or the red shirts in the middle of your picture. Canada, are they holding back because they have fast finishes, or are they really giving it their all?
Yeah, I'm not too sure. I think they're in a good position to come back from. Whether they've gone out too slow or gone out too hard, I'm not too sure. But they are still in a very doable position to win from. So, yeah, we're coming up to 200 metres to go, and it's still a 4-5 horse race here.
France up slightly pulling ahead, but as you mentioned, there's 4 boats in it. We have Poland. Canada now making a move, coming back in the middle of your picture. But France are moving to half a boat length ahead, with Spain still in the actual race. Well, we're coming down to the last 150 metres. And it's looking to hit 2-horse race here.
France, whether they can hold on or not, it's coming down really close with Poland.
Against Poland. We're now in the last 50 metres to go. And France look like they decided to want to take the race. In fact, they take it rather easily. They take it about half a boat length from Poland that led most of the race. Delighted with themselves, giving themselves a traditional tap on the back of the hand.
For a 1,000-metre race, that was very tight between first and fifth, basically. It's good to see a really tight racing this early on in the year.
Well, they're not completely youngsters. We have Matthew Bugnet, who is 31 years old in the bow. He's a fireman, and Adrian Bauer, who's 23 years old in the Europeans. 2 weeks ago, they came 6th together in the Worlds in 2014. They again came 6th together, so it's great to see them making their mark. They first competed internationally that I have the results for, which was back in 2011. So they're making a lot of finals, but I'd say they're not probably one of the world beaters at the moment, but they've won the race today by a good half a boat length. So in the last 100 metres, they did a Kenny special almost.
Yeah, they seem to control the race from the start. They race their own race as such, and with a strong finish out there, that tailwind, they obviously didn't go out too hard, but they made sure they were in the race, and then they timed it perfectly to come home and win by half a boat.
Well, that's good. Just briefly about yourself, we've been asking you to come in, but it's the first time you haven't been racing. I believe you told me the other day on a Sunday since 2005.
Yeah, it's very interesting to not have been racing. I feel like I've cheated myself only doing 2 races this weekend.
Well, the results are coming there. And official, France, 3 minutes 33.908. Poland second, Canada, they've came back. We didn't talk about them much, but they've managed to hang on to take a medal, which is great for them.
Anytime you're on the podium, it's a good time.
So, yes, sorry, we're talking about yourself. You feel like you're cheating people, but you took a gold away from the weekend, so it's still 100%.
Yeah, no, it is good. I only managed to do 2 races.
Well, let's go into one of the big races of the weekend. It's the men's K4. We have You can see two teams from Spain. One's put a couple of results in, the others are fairly unknown. A team from Australia we'll talk about as soon as we see them on the actual screen. But it's the quality of the field today, you say?
There's definitely some good guys in there. That's for sure. Portugal, Spain, Australia.
Portugal, we saw them in the second in the Worlds and second in the Europeans. So they're looking to put forward something together. France, they are disappointed. They're a new format. They only came sixth or seventh in the Europeans a couple of weeks ago. They said that's unfortunately our level, but we're still working on it, pushing forward because they have big aspirations. This is the Spanish team that won in Milan last year, and they've had another couple of good results, so perhaps they're favoured from the Spanish.
Yeah, they are. At World Championships, they didn't have the best race. They had some rudder problems, so I'm pretty sure they're out to redeem themselves this year. And with Javi in the front, he's looking the goods, the white paddle and the bandana. He's a very stylish man.
Well, Brady Reed and his teammates have already been out on the water once. They were out about an hour ago because some of them had to go through qualifications again, semi-final qualifications. Again, a Chinese team here. Interesting to see how strong they were. I think they came second in the Asian Games. And you talk about this.
Yeah, the Australian crew here, we've got a new combination again. They've stuck a young guy, Jordan Wood, a silver medalist from under 23 Worlds, into the back of the boat there. So it'll be interesting to see how they go. They had a really good heat against Spain and Portugal yesterday. So they're just coming into the blocks now, getting ready.
And Brazil, sorry, I haven't mentioned too much, but they're at the bottom. I don't think that's a great advantage for any particular lane today. It doesn't seem like it.
No, it seems to be pretty much a straight tail, which is good. In the last few days, it has been a little bit of a crosswind. So today, I think there should be some really fast times, like into the low 2 minutes 50.
Well, you're a specialist in Australia. What are their tactics going to be?
Normally they get out really strong, but I think because they are a new crew, they're going to try a few different tacks and just kind of just grind their way into it and come home strong, hopefully.
Well, we saw your first images in your picture were Portugal, as it's Portugal. We're editing the actual event, and it's their major team. It's not surprising they're going to see them at the moment. It's up for someone else, maybe the Spanish, to take a good lead. Then we'll have to focus on them.
Yeah, there's a lot of guys here backing up races. You'll see Pimenta in front of that Portugal boat. You know, he won the K1 yesterday, so he's known how to race. And there's another two guys in there that raced in the K2 and they're right up there. They got third. So, and the same with the Spanish and the French team. So there's a lot of people backing up. Murray's in the front, in the second seat of the Australian K4. He backed up from the K1 yesterday. Jordan Wood was in the K2. So there's a lot of guys backing up there. They're going strong.
Well, Spain in your picture at the moment. Two Spanish teams. Do you know if it's a trial?
No, I'm not too sure if it's a trial, but the Spanish crew that's in front, they're a under 23 crew. So whoever experience here will come back to bite them, but they've definitely gone out strong. Just like every other race, the Spanish crew seems to always get out strong, but through the halfway mark, they're three quarters of a boat in front. That's great.
Well, Spain 1, Spain 2. Czech Republic, obviously, who are the team to beat at the moment, they're going to be clearly they're not here this week. I believe they're going to be in Duisburg next week, but let's see how the race is today. So far, we're coming down to the instinct section, and Spain are still holding together.
Yeah, they're still holding strong. I reckon that the Australian crew should be, I'm going to favour them as well, but I think they should be pushing pretty hard through this third 250, and it'll be interesting to see where they are at the end. We just can't see them on the screen at the moment. But
they're down in lane 7.
Yeah, and the second Spanish crew is coming right up. There's the Australian crew just there in third spot, and Portugal seems to be just in fourth. It's really tight with 200 metres to go.
So far, Spain 1, Spain 2. Can Australia come back?
The front Spanish team seems to be hurting a little bit, but can they hold on? As soon as they hit these red boards, it's only 100 metres to go, so they're just about to cross to the 100-metre boys, and looks like Australia might just be tucking in front. They are.
Australia have something special in their breakfast because they've really decided to put the pedal to the metal, as they say, and it looks like they're going to come away. And yes, in fact, they are. They take a victory by almost half a boat length from Spain, and lane number 4 again, Spain.
Yeah, I think that there's a lot of emotion in that boat at the moment. There's a lot of claiming going on. It's a new crew, so they weren't too sure exactly the race experience. There's three guys in there with a lot of race experience, but they're all swapping seats around and a few different combinations, so it's good to see how good they've actually done it. And Jordan Wood in the back seat, you know, for a young guy to come away, that's his, I believe it's one of his first World Cups. He raced last year in the World Cups, but to come away for gold medal this time, it's, yeah, that's good. And to come back through the field as well, that's a really different tact by the Australian crew, so that's good to see.
So for Jordan, will there be some sort of initiation rites? Will he be thrown off the boat? Or will it...
I'm not too sure. Like, it's definitely looking good. It's, you know, World Championships this year, Olympic qualifying. It's more of a chess game on who's going to go into what boat and whether they keep the K4 the way it is, they keep the K2, the K1, you know, how it all works out. The goal is to qualify the maximum amount of athletes, and at this stage, it's looking pretty good.
So they have actually switched quite a few round, really, haven't they, from the gold medal Olympic winning team?
They have. Basically, David Smith, Murray and Jake have all moved up one seat, and they've put Smith in the front. And I think just maybe not the experience in the K4 with Jordan, they've just stuck him straight in the back seat and basically put your seatbelt on and hold on it and just push as hard as you can. So, and yeah, Jordan's a great athlete. He's got a lot of talent, and he'll die before he stops battling. So he hurts himself every single day in training. He hurts himself out there in the race. So he goes to the death.
Well, here are the official results. Australia take the gold in 2:48, followed by Spain. Spain with Portugal just missing out of the medals. But I guess it's so early in the season, you can't take too much information away from that. But all we can see is Australia take another gold medal after we saw the K2 1000 with Lockie Tame and Kenny Wallace yesterday, the two guests we're speaking with at the moment. So will there be, what information can they take away from that race?
Well, pretty much that time, no matter what, even though it is a tailwind, it's really good conditions out there to do a good time, but a 2:48 any day of the week is a cracker of a time. So they'll look at that and just go, hey, look, you know, we're on the money, let's hold our ground here. And that's great. 2:48, I thought it was going to be a low 250s, but yeah, that's pretty fast. So be interested to see what they do next week in Duisburg as well, and race a whole different crew, because the Australians will race the same crew, but the Spanish crew and the Portuguese crew will not be at Duisburg, so they'll be racing the Czech and all the other crews there as well. So that'll be good.
Inside information coming to you live from ICF TV here, and we're going to have the second medal ceremony of the day, and it's going to be the fastest guys on the planet. It's the men's K1 200 meters. And it's good to see, well, I suppose if you're French, it's good to see they have a pairing, Sylvester Juvet, who was the world champion in K2 200 meters in 2010-2011, with Arnaud Ibois, who we saw racing in the K2s. They just pipped by the post yesterday in the K2 1000 meters. And Marc de Jong, hopefully he feels he doesn't like the position he's going to be in today.
Any time you're on the podium, like I said before, is a good time to be. It's always good. And over 200 metres, it's early on in the year. They'll walk away with a gauge from this and go, hey, look, we're pretty close. You know, what do we do in training? What do we change in between now and next weekend? Did we get a good start? Didn't we get a bad start? So there's a lot they'll take away from this, and a lot of guys here will use this as a solid training weekend.
Sébastien Juvet from France, who's been around forever, keeps his motivation up, obviously, and great for him to pick up an individual medal here.
Oh, it's great. I've actually stood on the podium with him before, over 500 metres as well. So, going from 500 down to 200, he is a very talented paddler, that's for sure.
Vincent, the team leader from France, he gives great information, by the way, about who's doing what from the French team. They're very open about that. He's handing out the flowers. And you can just see the top of the head of Frank Garner, who's the chief of the ICF sprint committee, giving the medal to Marc de Jong from Canada, who didn't he briefly retire a few years ago because he missed the squad for the Olympics and then came back and was quite delighted?
Marc de Jong
is cut off there. It's Maxime Beaumont who's taken the gold medal, and delighted about. Lockie was telling us he's looking good in the heats already, so it's obviously a form continues for the whole weekend.
I could be a little misinformed. My information's not 100% here, but I believe he might have just had a little baby as well, Maxime. So you know, life's changing for him as well, if that is true.
But slightly different physical aspect from the women. You can race 10 minutes later.
Yeah, that's as soon as you're sober up.
There we go, French National Anthem. The first time we've heard the Marseillaise this weekend. The French team should be on form because they really did. They had the French trials a couple of weeks ago, so they needed to peak for that. Perhaps not as competitive as the slalom team, but it's still a high level, and they are posing on the Saumur. Yesterday, we saw some good racing. I believe we had 9 finals in total, and we had Hungary coming top of the actual medal table with 4 medals in total, but there were, I think that out of the 9 races, there were 7 or 8 different nationalities. And this regatta is quite different from most of them because there's a large percentage of non-European athletes taking place. So some of the other nations, like Argentina, Brazil, Cuba, they've had a real chance to test quite a lot of their athletes and see what it's going to be like in the next year or so.
Yeah, the program for this year with European Championships and the Baku European Games as well, and having the 3 World Cups back to back, it's very hard for some countries to even logistically get the boats from place to place. So, I think they're picking and choosing what regattas to go to. And like you said, there are a lot more non-European countries here to get some more race experience. We don't have as many races back in Australia or New Zealand or anywhere else. So it's always good to come over here and, you know, test and see where we're at, because we've got very different seasons going on. We've just come out of summer. And in Australia, it's going into winter, and these guys have just come out of winter, going into summer. So, it's always good, and it's very hard to gauge where we are.
Do you find there's a different vibe in the clubhouse, but when you all have lunch together, because there's no Germans, and we'll talk about this later. C1 men 500 meter final. Some of the athletes have been on the water this morning. So Mark Oldershaw and a few of the others had to go through a semi-final. Attila Viada put one that 1:57 yesterday. We actually interviewed him 5 minutes later. He was still puffing. He said he was quite tired, but he's in the middle of the lane. And Vincent Slominski, this is going to be the second race today. I think he had 2 yesterday. Chang Li, he is a Asian game winner and came 7th, I believe, in the world in the C1 1000 last year. Helder Silver, normally known for his short distances. Did he pick up a medal yesterday in the C1 200s? But he's certainly there or thereabouts, and it's going to be interesting to see how they come on, with Chen here from China putting in another performance. The 500s, well, in kayaks, you've got a good pedigree. Can you compare it to the I always see you say that similar sort of quote for the difference between a 500 and a 1000 meter race. What is it?
For me, the 500, it's half the distance but twice as hard. So you literally go out as hard as you can.
Well, Mark Oldershaw took a really outstanding victory yesterday. He led from the start to the finish. He said he was a good tailwind, so he decided to go out fast and see if he could keep going, and he was delighted that he could. So he's already has a gold. Mojalel Imogadaram. Adel, we're going to be calling him from here. And there's a few Iranians actually making the final, which is, again, great to see.
Oh, it is good to see him over here racing and doing really well, actually. Like you said, making finals as well. There's another K1 paddler that's doing really well.
China, Chang Li, he was unwell in February, had a month off training, so they're delighted that he managed to come back yesterday and take a medal. And Slominski, we've talked about him quite a lot. I have talked about him quite a lot this morning because he's been in all the races. And Helder Silva, frequent we've seen in the World Cup, putting in good performances. He seems to start like lightning. I don't know what he's got in his boat, but he seems to do something. And Thiago Tavares, again from Portugal.
They'll be looking forward to the home crowd advantage here.
To Portugal, to China. And Jonathan Jones, it's great to see the UK have put up a development squad.
Yeah, well, under-23 World Championships are going to be here later on in the year, so they're just getting a feel for the water, feel for the what's around here. So it's not a bad, it's a really smart move by the Great Britain team.
And the difference between 200 metres and 1,000 is 200, you start flat out. What's the tactics in? Oh, bad start there for Great Britain. What are the tactics going to be in here?
The 500 is not too much different. These guys will be going out as hard as they can. They've got one move, I reckon, that they can do is go out hard and then try to go harder. And who can hold on? So I know Attila Vida had a really good heat yesterday, so I think he'll be very hard to beat. Mark Oldershaw is very experienced as well. Both those guys are Olympic medalists, so they're side by side, and we'll see how they go.
Geng Li from China is taking them out as we speak.
He's had a cracker of a start, almost a boat length lead. He's going for it.
And Portugal as well are looking to say we have China well ahead of the others. We have Thiago Tavares at the top of your picture in the very dark boat. Again, he's just taking a second place. But so far, halfway through the race, we have a full boat length for China ahead of Portugal. And Mark Oldershaw is still in the mix.
Yeah, China just keeps him to be surprising. There's a new guy every time, and it's the same in across the board. They just keep pumping out these athletes. It'll be good to see where they are in August as well, and if they can continue their form. But it looks like Mark's starting to make his move. And
Mark
Oldershaw
pushing, as you mentioned, he's in the... Oh, we're not going to see it yet. There's China in lane seven there, but we saw Mark Oldershaw really, really deciding that he wants to have a double for the weekend.
Yeah, 100 metres to go, and he is going for it. It could come down to the shoot, the little kick out that they do, and it's starting to look tight. They're trying to get... Chinese guys are holding on, but Mark's looking very strong, so it might come
three
down to the
in
shoot.
The lead at the moment. It's Mark Oldershaw with the experience pushing forward. There's going to be four in the line, but it looks like unless China's coming back, it's going to be Canada from possibly China.
I think the Chinese guy held on for second then. That was a great. He put it all out there. He put it out on the line. He went out strong and managed to hold on. So that was a great race by him. And Mark seemed to have timed it well. We're still going to wait for the official results. But from where I was sitting, it looked like Mark might have just got it.
And also, we didn't mention Adele that much. But from Iran, unless mistaken, he put in a cracking race.
Yeah, it's great to see how these guys out here racing as hard as they can and in the finals and not just making the finals, but being a force to reckon with.
Well, Mark Oldershaw, he has, when he's chilling, he has these very jazzy yellow glasses, and obviously he has his white racing glasses and probably several others, but it's...
There's a lot of fashionable people getting around this regatta this time around, so...
Well, it's only 10, 15 centimetres, but I think it's clear enough that Mark Oldershaw backs up his win yesterday in the C1 1,000 metres to take it in the C1 500. I think his place is safe now to go and qualify for the Worlds and the Pan American Games that are taking place. And he's good. Well, yesterday he was very modestly saying, or was it you saying good day at the office? I think he was saying the same sort of byline in his Twitter and Facebook and what have you, but it was seems to be going well. Clearly the Russians might have something to say, but yes, it's the official. Mark Oldershaw takes the victory, Chang Li takes the second place, and Adel Mojalal Imogadamadam, something like that, takes the bronze medal for Iran, with Slominski again just missing out. He takes the fourth level, and you can see Attila Varda, who yesterday when I was speaking to him about the fact that he qualified in the fastest time, he was like almost like, it doesn't mean anything. It's the trials start in 2 weeks' time. A bit of information about from Attila Varda, who's a pretty much a living legend in Hungary because it's one of their national sports. He's hopefully trying to go for the Rio and said he might try and go C2 in Tokyo.
Yeah, that was great. Now,
on to the K1 500 meters in lane number five, Adam van Coverden. I still believe he has the fastest time ever.
I believe he does actually. He does have a faster time than me.
Let's see who else we can actually get in there. Cyril Carey, who has been, he's getting closer to the medals in France from lane three. And we do have Suzuki for Japan. Martin McDowell, who's now training with Gordon Walker, is putting a good final result. I should really shut up and let you talk about this because it's your event.
There was a lot of guys yesterday through the heats that did some really fast times. This Brazilian guy here, he was very happy. He was claiming the heat yesterday. He was very emotional that how good he'd went. Adam, so much experience, Olympic champion, multiple Olympic medalists, 500 metres. He's still got it. He could almost, I'm not going to put the mocker on him, but he could almost win this event just on experience. Suzuki, he's done some training out in Australia. Every time he comes out to Australia, he's a little bit larger and does some hard training and gets a bit small. Cyril, he's a great paddler. Like in the last couple of years, he's really stepped up his game. He's always managed to be there, but the last couple of years, he's really stepped up. Marty McDowell, he really impressed me this weekend so far. He's really been going out strong and really hard and managing to hold on. So he's really doing it tough. Jost here, he's probably not the fastest starter, but he hangs in there, he holds on. So, and Louis here, he didn't have a bad race yesterday either, so in the heat. So Daniel Johnson, another one of the young guys here from Great Britain, so he'll be taking in every bit of experience he can get. And Chris Miak here, lane 9, he's just qualified into the final, so he'll be looking to again get some more experience and just put it all out there. So
any regrets you're not racing?
Kinda, yeah. But the way the program worked out this weekend, it was pretty tough to be able to do. But Suzuki's already out to a strong start, but whether he can hold on. Adam seems to have just missed that start slightly, but...
Marty McDowell in lead number 7 looks like he's really pushing it down heavily, but he did the same in yesterday in the 1,000, started quickly.
Yeah, he always, in the last couple of days, he's been getting out really strong and just managing to hold on, but I think Adam will move through after 150 metres to the halfway mark and try and cement his spot there. But
in the white tip fade, Silkari at the top of the picture with the cap. He's also in there. And in lane number 5, it's, as you mentioned, Adam van Cuverden with the red, yellow, white boat. He's not using the new boat.
No, he's very happy in his boat at the moment. He hasn't done too many trials in the new Chinko, but me and Adam have got a very similar boat, actually, that we use at the moment. We just haven't done the hard kilometres in it, but we're coming through halfway, and Cyril and Adam are absolutely hooking along, and Marty's just hanging in there for third, so whether he can hold on for the rest of the race, it'd be great, but it's going to be tight between Cyril and Adam. On experience, I'll back Adam, but Cyril is going for it.
Well, they had it mentioned again, they had this 28-year-old fireman for Auxerre, but they actually had their internal trials a couple of weeks ago, so he's designed to peak at the moment. But he's coming into the last 100 metres, and Silkari could be slightly pulling ahead of Adam van Cuverden at the middle of your picture. It's going to be clear now that Silkari has really decided he wants the win, so 50 metres to go, and Silkari is going to take it. But it looks like Adam van Cuverden is going to take the silver. Who's going to take the bronze? We don't know. France take first, Canada take second, and New Zealand have a medal of well.
Oh, that's a great race by Cyril, and you could see how much he was hurting in that last 100 metres or so. Adam, I know that he was hurting, but he still looked good, but great race by Cyril. He really pushed home in that last 100 metres, and Marty McDowell, they get a medal as well. That's great for New Zealand to get a medal in the men's here. So.
Well, Marty's not a spring chicken, is he? He's 27, 28, I say. He's with Gordon Walker, training a little bit with Lisa Carrington of Well. I wonder if that affects things.
Any time you've got an Olympic champion around you know, and a girl that knows how to win, you're always going to take something out of a leaf out of that book. So it's always good. You've got Adam here on the screen. He looks the same as now as what he did 5 years ago, just strong and powerful. But Cyril in that last 100 metres, it's amazing how much can change actually in that last 100. You can go from first to last pretty easily in that last 100 metres. So for Cyril, that's a great race by him. He's... No spring chicken either.
I was speaking to the coaches, French coaches, yesterday, and they were saying, well, 2 years ago, he was happy to make a final. Last year, he was touching almost the medals. And then this year, the unofficial results, Silkawe from France takes it in 137.9. They've given second to Marty McDowell. I'd say that's wrong. They're probably looking, unless something dramatic's happened, it looks like Adam van Cuverden was going to take second and Marty McDowell at third. I say it is unofficial, but I'm pretty sure that there's a challenge there. And I know the starters have had a few, the timers have had a few challenges, but certainly the unofficial, they look at the photo finish, and we know Silkawe was the first across the line, Adam van Cuverden for Canada was second across the line, and New Zealand's Marty McDowell was third across the line.
Yeah, that's again. Well, we know those guys are getting on the podium either way. They can arm wrestle it out when they get up here to get their medals.
The familiar voice is Kenny Wallace. You can see, look, I'm talking about the hangar a few minutes ago. This is where you pass a lot of your day having a laugh, really. That's every time you go past, there's laughter coming from most of the camps.
Yeah, it is. This course seems to be, it's kind of in the middle of, if you can see the surroundings, it's in the middle of these fields everywhere, and there's this giant hangar, like you said. And it's great. Everyone's in there. Inside the hangars, you've got TVs, so you can watch the live streaming here as well.
The beanie chairs, it's comfortable, isn't it? It seems to be plenty of room. Because there's only 28 teams here, there seems to be a little bit more room.
There definitely is, and the Portuguese Canoe Federation have really put on a great regatta. Everything's running smoothly. It makes it easy as an athlete to get through it. So.
Well, it looks like there's lots of non-European teams here. It's the K4 Women 500-metre final. And Australia against New Zealand. In theory, one of the Australians is significantly better than the others. China have a good position, and again, going through them. So they're not Hungary, they're not Belarus, they're not Russia, but we still have some good experience here.
Yeah, definitely. It's great to have the two Australian crews racing off against each other in lanes 2 and 3. One crew, like you said, might be that little bit stronger, but New Zealand has really stepped it up as well. You just saw them on screen. They have got a great women's team here.
They're large, aren't they? They're very strong ladies. Tennille Hatton has not elected to take part, so they've got a new team that's been together about 3 or 4 months now, and it looks like they've been doing some really good work.
Yeah, Portugal on the screen. Again, the home crowd advantage there. They always seem to be in the finals and going. Joe Brigden-Jones, Naomi Flood, Alana Nichols, and my little sister Bernadette Wallace in that K4, the French K4 here on screen now.
Well, the French K4, they've been mixing it around quite a lot of well in the last couple of years.
Here's the other Australian crew now. A lot of young talent in that crew, and I'll be interested to see how they go in this. The Spanish crew here, I'm going to pick that they're going to get out strong. The Spanish have done it in every other race. The Hungarian crew, another young crew here again as well.
They'd be looking to push the senior team. The senior team for Hungary, it's interesting. And Poland, they actually had to come through the semi-final this morning, but they've got stacked with top names that they are switching every few minutes. I don't know what their tactics are. Speaking to the coaches, and they're having fun, but they're switching all the time.
Yeah, I'm not too sure. Poland, they always seem to be in the final or just get in. And they haven't got the best start here, but again, here we go. The Spanish crew are out. They've got half a boat already, so... it's going to be a tight race.
And we didn't mention Portugal. They have some good experience and some not medal winning, but some good victories out there.
It's going to be a tough race here. I think they're going to be looking around for a low 1 minute 30s for time. So it'll be interesting to see whether the Portuguese crew can hold on here. They've gone out really strong, and hopefully that the grandstand in the last kind of 150 metres can bring them home.
Well, that's what they're looking about. Little sister, was she nervous this morning?
She was all right. She's done it plenty of times before, and they're going through, and they seem to be doing well.
Well, coming into 200 metres to go, it is Portugal who have a little lead, but it looks like New Zealand. Say it's a fairly new crew, but they're sneaking up on it again. They might be inspired by Lisa's performance, but it's at the moment we're coming close to the last stages in New Zealand. They have extraordinary power there.
They seem to be pushing just slowly, just gaining inch by inch. And looks like the Portuguese slightly slowing up, but New Zealand is going strong.
Out of the bottom of your picture, it's Poland are coming through. We can't actually see it in the picture. So at the moment, New Zealand are leading. They're probably going to be on the edge of their seats at home in New Zealand. So hello there. Cheer your team on. Coming the last 30 metres. New Zealand are going to take the victory. Who's going to take second? It's going to be Poland ahead of Portugal. So a new team, been together 3 months. New Zealand are obviously doing something correctly in their training, because they haven't a big team there. I think they have Scotty Bicknell doing the 200s, but we have Lovett, Fisher, Ryan, and Imrie. The two of the girls did really well yesterday in the K2 500s, the girls.
Yes. Yeah, that was again, not surprising that they're all working together really well. And the New Zealand crew, women's crew, have really stepped it up. That's it's really good to see. We like to call them our cousins. So the Australian men's crew taking out the Cayman on K4 1000, and the New Zealand's taking out the K4 500 for women. So that's
great. You're sharing news. A hangar, aren't you, today, this weekend?
We are sharing a hangar. So
there'll be a buzz there. I'm not sure how many. You're complaining that complaining that there's not enough beer around, because you normally like to have a beer after a race. But it's a great result for New Zealand. Yesterday I was talking to a couple of the girls who, was it silver they won yesterday? And I said, listen, I want to interview you. And you say, interview me for Moy, which is fine.
Yeah.
Because they've actually come forward. Look at this. Tell me about the style.
Well, they're going great. They seem so strong. They pushed through their last bit as well. They pushed through that last 100 metres. That they looked really strong, and to finish like that, it's really, really good. So, and you can see here they are happy about it, because first race of the year to actually get into it, they're really pumped.
Kenny, you've got 30 seconds to wrap up and say whatever you like about the weekend.
It's great to be here. It's great from the Portuguese Canoe Federation and the ICF to host such a great regatta. So,
break off 1 second. Official results then. New Zealand take the victory in 1:31 from Poland and Portugal with Australia. We didn't talk about them much, but younger sister takes the fourth place. Another 15 seconds, Kenny. Tell me what you like.
Yeah, it's great to see Australia here in fourth and the women. It's going to be interesting to see what they do. And like I said, it's a bit of a chess game towards August to try and qualify the amount of quotas. But it's great. Just great to be here and great to be racing.
Lucky Tame, Kenny Wallace, I'm Matthew Layton. Thank you very much for joining us. You can see with the ICF crew, media crew, they're going to be putting all the information on this site as soon as possible. Thank you for joining us. Tune in next week in Duisburg in Germany. Portugal, you've been fantastic. Thank you for the site. Thank you for everything about it. And we've had a lot of fun. And see you next weekend. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Senhoras e senhores, a cerimónia de entrega de medalhas da C1 200 metros feminino vai começar.
Ladies and gentlemen, the medal ceremony of the women's K1 200 meters will begin.
Senhoras e senhores, apresentamos as medalhadas da C1 200 metros feminino.
Ladies and gentlemen, we present the medalists of the women's C1 200 meters.
As medalhas serão entregues por Ricardo Machado, vice-presidente da Federação Portuguesa de Canoagem e do team leader do Canadá.
The medals will be presented by Ricardo Machado, the vice-president of the Portuguese Canoe Federation and the team leader of Canada.
E a medalhada de bronze é Valdenice Nascimento, do Brasil.
Bronze medalist, Valdenice Nascimento, from Brazil.
E a medalhada de prata é Katie Vincent, do Canadá.
The silver medalist, Katie Vincent, from Canada.
A medalhada de ouro e vencedora da Taça do Mundo é Laurence Vincent Lapointe, do Canadá.
And the gold medalist and World Cup winner is Laurence Vincent Lapointe from Canada.
Por favor, levantem-se para escutar o hino nacional do Canadá.
Please rise for the national anthem of Canada. Gentlemen, please give a warm round of applause for your 2015 World Cup medalists.
Senhoras e senhores, a cerimónia de entrega de medalhas da C2 200 metros masculinos vai começar.
Ladies and gentlemen, the medal ceremony for the men's C2 200 meters will begin.
Senhoras e senhores, apresentamos os medalhados da C2 200 metros masculino.
Ladies and gentlemen, we present the medalists of the men's C2 200 meters.
As medalhas serão entregues por Emílio Guerreiro, secretário de Estado do Desporto, e acompanhado pelo team leader da Polónia.
The medals will be presented by Emílio Guerreiro, the Portuguese Minister of Sport, and the team leader of Poland.
E os medalhados de bronze são Bruno Afonso, Nuno Silva, de Portugal.
The bronze medalists, Bruno Afonso and Nuno Silva, of Portugal.
E os medalhados de prata são Max Pullen, Aaron Rubley, do Canadá.
Silver medalists, Max Pullen and Aaron Rubley of Canada.
Os medalhados de ouro e vencedores da Taça do Mundo são Viktor Glazunov e Vincent Slominski.
The gold medalists and World Cup winners Viktor Glazunov and Vincent Slominski from Poland.
Por favor, levantem-se para escutar o hino nacional da Polónia.
Please rise for the national anthem of Poland.
Senhoras e senhores, pedimos o vosso aplauso aos vencedores da Taça do Mundo 2015.
Ladies and gentlemen, please give a warm round of applause for the 2015 World Cup medalists.
Senhoras e senhores, a cerimónia de entrega de medalhas do K1 1000 metros feminino vai começar.
Ladies and gentlemen, the medal ceremony of the women's K1 1000 meters will begin.
Senhoras e senhores, apresentamos as medalhadas do K1 1000 metros feminino.
Ladies and gentlemen, we present the medalists for the women's K1 1000 meters.
As medalhas serão entregues por Vítor Félix, presidente da Federação Portuguesa de Canoagem e pelo team leader da Hungria.
The medals will be presented by Vítor Félix, the president of the Portuguese Canoe Federation and the team leader of Hungary.
E a medalhada de bronze é Shang Li Li, da China.
Medalist Zhang Li Li from China.
A medalhada de prata é Laura Pedruelo de Espanha.
Silver medalist Laura Pedruelo from Spain.
A medalhada de ouro e vencedora da Taça do Mundo é Cristina Fazekas Zur, da Hungria.
The gold medalist and World Cup winner is Cristina Fazekas Zur from Hungary.
Por favor, levantem-se para escutar o hino nacional da Hungria.
Please rise for the national anthem of Hungary.
Senhoras e senhores, pedimos o vosso aplauso à vencedora da Taça do Mundo 2015.
Ladies and gentlemen, please give a warm round of applause for your 2015 World Cup medalists.
Senhoras e senhores, a cerimónia de entrega de medalhas da C2 mil metros masculino vai começar.
Ladies and gentlemen, the medal ceremony of the men's C2 1000 meters will begin.
Senhoras e senhores, apresentamos os medalhados da C2 mil metros masculino.
Ladies and gentlemen, we present the medalists for the men's C2 1000 meters.
As medalhas serão entregues por Emílio Torrão, presidente da Câmara Municipal de Montemor-o-Velho, e pelo team leader de França.
The medals will be presented by Emílio Torrão, the mayor of Montemor, and the team leader of France.
E os medalhados de bronze são Benjamin Russell, Gabriel Buchesny Sevigny, do Canadá.
Bronze medalists Benjamin Russell and Gabriel Buchesny Sevigny from Canada.
E os medalhados de prata são Mateusz Kaminski e Michał Kudla, da Polónia.
Silver medalists, Mateusz Kaminski and Michał Kudla from Poland.
Os medalhados de ouro e vencedores da Taça do Mundo são Mathieu Bonnier, Adrien Bart, de França.
Gold medalists and World Cup winners, Mathieu Bonnier and Adrien Bart from France.
Por favor, levantem-se para escutar o hino nacional de França.
Please rise for the national anthem of France.
Senhoras e senhores, o vosso aplauso para os vencedores da Taça do Mundo 2015.
Ladies and gentlemen, please give a warm round of applause for your 2015 World Cup medalists.
Senhoras e senhores, a cerimónia de entrega de medalhas do K4 mil metros masculino vai começar.
Ladies and gentlemen, the medal ceremony of the men's K4 1000 meters will begin.
Senhoras e senhores, apresentamos os medalhados do K4 mil metros masculino.
Ladies and gentlemen, we present the medalists of the men's K4 1000 meters.
As medalhas serão entregues por Simon Tolson, secretário-geral da Federação Internacional de Canoagem, e acompanhado pelo team leader da Austrália.
The medals will be presented by Simon Tolson, the secretary-general of the International Canoe Federation and the team leader of Australia.
E os medalhados de bronze, Gabriel Pavón, Albert Martí, Roy Rodríguez, Ruben Milán, de Espanha.
The bronze medalists, Gabriel Pavón, Roy Rodríguez, Albert Martí and Ruben Milán, from Spain.
E os medalhados de prata são Javier Hernández, Óscar Carrera, Rodrigo Germán e Íñigo Peña, de Espanha.
Silver medalists, Javier Hernández, Rodrigo Germán, Óscar Carrera and Íñigo Peña, from Spain.
Medalhados de ouro e vencedores da Taça do Mundo, David Smith, Jacob Clear, Murray Stewart, Jordan Wood, da Austrália.
All medalists and World Cup winners are David Smith, Murray Stewart, Jacob Clear and Jordan Wood from Australia.
Por favor, levantem-se para escutar o hino nacional da Austrália.
Please rise for the national anthem of Australia.
Senhoras e senhores, pedimos o vosso aplauso aos vencedores da Taça do Mundo 2015.
Ladies and gentlemen, please give a warm round of applause for your 2015 World Cup medalists.
Senhoras e senhores, a cerimónia de entrega de medalhas da C1 500 metros masculino vai começar.
Ladies and gentlemen, the medal ceremony for the men's C1 500 meters will begin.
Senhoras e senhores, apresentamos os medalhados da C1 500 metros masculino.
Ladies and gentlemen, we present the medalists for the men's C1 500 meters.
As medalhas serão entregues por José Sousa, vice-presidente da Federação Portuguesa de Canoagem, e pelo team leader do Canadá.
The medals will be presented by José Sousa, the vice-president of the Portuguese Canoe Federation and the team leader of Canada.
E o medalhado de bronze é Adel Mojalali Mogadam, do Irão.
The bronze medalist, Adel Mojalali Mogadam, from Iran.
O medalhado de prata é Qiang Li, da China.
Silver medalist, Qiang Li, from China.
E o medalhado de ouro e vencedor da Taça do Mundo é Mark Oldershaw, do Canadá.
And your gold medalist and World Cup winner is Mark Oldershaw from Canada.
Por favor, levantem-se para escutar o hino nacional do Canadá.
Rise for the National Anthem of Canada.
Senhoras e senhores, pedimos o vosso aplauso ao vencedor da Taça do Mundo 2015.
Ladies and gentlemen, please give a warm round of applause for your 2015 World Cup medalists.
E dentro de momentos vamos seguir com a entrega dos prémios. Falta apenas o K1 500 metros, é já de seguida. Estamos só a resolver um pequeno problema técnico. E depois fiquem para a entrega dos prémios do K4 feminino. Vamos ter as portuguesas no pódio. Senhoras e senhores, a cerimónia de entrega de medalhas do K1 500 metros masculino vai começar.
Ladies and gentlemen, the medal ceremony of the men's K1 500 meters will begin.
Senhoras e senhores, apresentamos os medalhados do K1 500 metros masculino.
Ladies and gentlemen, we present the medalists of the men's K1 500 meters.
As medalhas serão entregues por Carlos Cardoso, presidente da Confederação do Desporto de Portugal e pelo team leader de França.
The medals will be presented by Carlos Cardoso, the president of the Portuguese Confederation of Sport and the team leader of France.
E o medalhado de bronze é Marty McDowell, da Nova Zelândia.
The bronze medalist, Marty McDowell, from New Zealand.
E o medalhado de prata é Adam Van Coverden, do Canadá.
The silver medalist, Adam Van Coverden, from Canada.
O medalhado de ouro e vencedor da Taça do Mundo é Cyril Carré, de França.
The gold medalist and the World Cup winner is Cyril Carré, from France.
Por favor, levantem-se para escutar o hino nacional de França.
Please rise for the national anthem of France.
Senhoras e senhores, pedimos o vosso aplauso ao vencedor da Taça do Mundo 2015. As medalhas foram entregues por Carlos Marta, da Fundação do Desporto.
Ladies and gentlemen, please give a warm round of applause for your 2015 World Cup medalists.
Senhoras e senhores, a cerimónia de entrega de medalhas do K4 500 metros feminino vai começar.
Ladies and gentlemen, the medal ceremony of the women's K4 500 meters will begin.
Senhoras e senhores, apresentamos as medalhadas do K4 500 metros feminino.
Ladies and gentlemen, we present the medalists for the women's K4 500 meters.
As medalhas serão entregues por Emílio Guerreiro, secretário de Estado do Desporto, e pelo team leader da Nova Zelândia.
The medals will be presented by Emílio Guerreiro, the Portuguese Minister for Sport, and the team leader of New Zealand.
E as medalhadas de bronze, Joana Vasconcelos, Beatriz Gomes, Francisca Laia e Helena Rodrigues.
Bronze medalists, Joana Vasconcelos, Beatriz Gomes, Francisca Laia and Helena Rodrigues from Portugal.
E as medalhadas de prata, Carolina Naia, Evelina Wojnarowska, Ana Vlosik e Beata Mikołajczyk da Polónia.
The silver medalists, Carolina Naia, Evelina Wojnarowska, Ana Vlosik and Beata Mikołajczyk from Poland.
E a medalha de ouro e vencedoras da Taça do Mundo, Jamie Lovett, Amy Fisher, Caitlin Ryan, Kyla Amory, da Nova Zelândia.
Gold medalists and World Cup winners, Jamie Lovett, Caitlin Ryan, Amy Fisher and Kyla Amory from New Zealand.
Por favor, levantem-se para escutar o hino nacional da Nova Zelândia.
Please rise for the national anthem of New Zealand.
Senhoras e senhores, o vosso aplauso às vencedoras da Taça do Mundo 2015.
Ladies and gentlemen, please give a warm round of applause for your 2015 World Cup medalists.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, that's the end of the action for this morning. We'll be back at 2 o'clock this afternoon for the B finals in the men's and women's K1 200 metres. And that'll be followed by the finals of the women's and men's K4 200 metres. And then after a short break, we'll also have the women's K1, men's C1 and men's K1 5,000 metre racing. So be sure to be back here at 2 o'clock when we'll kick off with the B final of the women's K1 200 metres.
E temos então agora uma pequena pausa. Às 2 horas voltamos com as finais B. Vamos ter o Hugo Rocha logo às 2h05. E atenção a esta nossa equipa do K4 feminino que recebeu agora a medalha. Elas ainda vão correr nos 200 metros. Elas que fizeram um grande arranque nesta prova de 500 metros. Vão correr às 2h10 e depois às 2h05. You stood there.